اللهم
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. عظم الله لكم الأجر يا شيعة بقرب محرم وما هي إلا أيام. وننادي يا حسين يا أبا عبد الله. عظم الله لك الأجر يا رسول الله ويا أمير المؤمنين ويا فاطمة يا سيدتي نساء العالمين. إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون.
ما شاء الله لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. حسبنا الله حسبنا الله ونعم الوكيل نعم المولى ونعم النصير. ربي اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله الذي جعل الحمد مفتاحا لذكره وسببا للمزيد من فضله ودليلا على آلائه وعظمته. ثم الصلاة والسلام والتحية والإكرام على النبي الأمي المكي المدني الهاشمي الذي سمي في السماوات بأحمد وفي الأراضين بأبي القاسم محمد. وعلى أهل بيته الأطيبين الأطهرين سيما أولهم أمير المؤمنين وآخرهم بقية الله في الأراضين روحي وأرواح العالمين لتراب مقدمه الفداء. ورحمة الله على محبيهم ومواليهم وشيعتهم أجمعين. ولعنة الله على أعدائهم وغاصب حقوقهم ومنكري فضائلهم ملعونين. أما بعد، قال المعصوم عليه السلام: هلاك المرء في الثلاث، الكبر والحرص والحسد. For the happiness of Hazrat Zahra-i Marziya, for the enlightenment of the graves of your marhumin, of the graves of the Shahada, Ulama, and Siddiqeen, for the safety of the followers of Ahlul Bayt around the world, and for the safety and the hastening of the reappearance of Hazrat Baqiyatullah al-A'zam Arwahun al-Fida, please recite your loudest salawat. All praise is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one who's Ahman and the one who's Rahim. All praise is due to that Lord that has granted us the honor of being from amongst the Azadar of Sayyid al-Shuhada, that has granted us the honor of being from amongst the Muhibban and the Shia of Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam. It's an honor for me to be given this opportunity to come and speak to you brothers and sisters for the next few nights. And there is a disclaimer that I will give, and I gave yesterday at the Mahfil as well, and that is that undoubtedly, in some way, shape or form, I may offend you in the coming nights. And that's probably, that is definitely not my intention. However, the topics that we will speak about relate around the nafs and certain akhlaqi problems that we find within ourselves on the journey towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so as a result, at times the nafs likes to kick back. But know that inshallah it's not my intention to offend you in any way, shape or form, but rather I'm just highlighting issues and problems that I myself see within myself on this journey towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Please recite the salawat. No. We've gathered to remember the one that is known as Kareem Ali Muhammad, the one that possessed magnanimity. And this is not to say that the other imams were not kareem, but rather when we say that, for example, Imam al-Radha is alime Ali Muhammad, or that Imam al-Hasan salawatullah wasalamu alayhi is the kareem of Ali Muhammad, it's not that any of the other imams did not possess this characteristic, but rather it is that this characteristic was present in all of them. But in each of the imams, one of these characteristics made its zuhur, made itself known more than others. For example, Imam al-Jawad became Jawad, but that doesn't mean that the other imams weren't Jawad. So Imam al-Hasan alayhi salam is known as Kareem Ali Muhammad. But along with that magnanimity, the imam is also arguably one of the most mazloom from amongst the imams of Ali Muhammad. Why? Because every other imam that I have found within history was mazloom at the hands of his enemies. His enemies didn't understand him. And so they would taunt him and say things that would hurt the feelings of the imam. But Imam al-Hasan is that imam that his own Shia turned against him. Every other imam faced dhulm at the hands of people from outside the fold of tashayyu, outside the fold of his own family. But Imam al-Hasan is that imam that is poisoned from within his family by his own wife. Imam al-Hasan is that imam that is mazloom at the hands of his own Shias. When he signs the peace treaty with Muawiyah, you know, the narrations say that the Muslims would come towards him, or the Shia, so-called Shia, people like Adi ibn Hatim al-Ta'i, who fought with Amir al-Mu'mineen in Siffin, was by the side of Amir al-Mu'mineen. But yet now when he sees Imam al-Hasan alayhi salam, after he signs the peace treaty with Muawiyah, he addresses him, says, As-salamu alayki ya mudhill al-Mu'mineen. Says, oh, salam be upon the one that made the Mu'mineen zaleel, that humiliated the Mu'mineen. But Imam al-Hasan, like all of the other imams, but more so he displayed this hilm, this husnul khulq, this forbearance, this good akhlaq. And there's countless stories in the life of the imam where an individual can see the hilm of the imam. However, I don't want to dwell too much on stories. And those of you that may have already heard my lectures, I don't really do the storytelling thing very well. Rather, Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam came for a reason, for a purpose. To take human beings towards kamal, towards perfection. Through their actions, through their words, they were guides towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-fulk al-jariyati fil-lujaj al-ghamira. In Salawat Sha'baniya of Imam al-Sajjad, when we address Ahlul Bayt, we say to them, oh Ahlul Bayt, you are al-fulk al-jariyati fil-lujaj al-ghamira, that you are those arks that sail upon unfathomless seas. يَأْمَنُ مَنْ رَكِبَهَا وَيَغْرَقُ مَنْ تَرَكَهَا الْمُتَقَدِّمُ لَهُمْ مَارِكُ وَالْمُتَأَخِّرُ عَنْهُمْ زَاهِقُ وَاللَّازِمُ لَهُمْ لَاهِقُ. That, O Ahlul Bayt, those that went ahead of you perished, those that stayed too far behind you were lost. But the one that stayed by you was eventually reunited with you, reached that ultimate goal that was Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They came to give us lessons. And so, with that in mind, We will look at one of the hadith from Imam al-Hasan, where the Imam speaks about the destruction of a human being. In this hadith, Imam says there are three things that will destroy the human being. Three characteristics, three actions that will lead to the destruction of the human being, men and women. It says, halakul mar'i fi thalath. Three things. What are they? Al-kibr. The first is pride. The second, wal-hirs, greed. The third, wal-hasad. The third is jealousy. It says all three of these will lead to the destruction. Then the Imam begins to explain. He says, فالكبر هلاك الدين وبه لعن إبليس. He says that كبر, تكبر, pride is the thing that will destroy your deen. It will destroy your religion, your iman. And it is the reason for why Iblis became mal'oon. It is why Satan became Satan, because of pride. 6,000 years he worshipped Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Amir al-Mu'mineen says we don't know whether it was 6,000 years of this dunya or 6,000 years of the akhirah, where each day is equivalent to 50,000 years. But for 6,000 years, he worshipped Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then one day, all those 6,000 years worth of worship went down the drain because of pride, asabiyya. Because he said, I'm made of fire and he's made of clay. How am I going to do sajda to him? Now, this isn't that all of a sudden he just developed pride. No, you see, these spiritual diseases, they remain as seeds within a person. They're there. But we just don't realize that they're there. They affect and they influence our actions and our behaviors. But we don't realize it. We just think, oh, it's just part of my personality. It's just what makes me me. But here, an individual like Iblis, with that pride, has lost 6,000 years worth of worship and has become mal'oon until Yawm al-Qiyamah. And he will continue to burn in the fires of hell as a result of that pride that he showed. All his worship for naught, because there was no ma'rifah in that worship. There was no depth of understanding within that worship. The ma'rifah that comes with worship, when a person is worshiping and analyzing his life, you'll see it in the story of Iblis that appears in certain narrations. Says that one day a sign appeared within the first heaven that said, my greatest servant will become my greatest enemy. So the angels from the first level of heaven said, this could be about us. So they went to the level of the second heaven, and they said to the angels there, look, pray for us. This sign has appeared. Pray that we are not the ones that become the greatest enemy of God. The angels in the second heaven say, look, we've seen the same sign as well. It could be us. Well, let us go to the third level. And then they go to the third level. Again, the same request. Again, the same reply. We've seen the same sign in our heaven. Let us go to the fourth level and the fifth level, and until they reach the seventh level of heaven. Now they say, look, we also saw this sign. We also saw this sign. It might be us. So let's go to Jibra'il. Sayyidul Malaika. Jibra'il This sign has appeared within the heavens. It says the greatest servant shall become the greatest enemy of God. Jibreel, do dua for us that it isn't us. Jibreel says, look, it might be in reference to me. Who knows? I may end up becoming the greatest enemy of God. So he says, what should we do? He says, let's go to one that is greater than us. Let's go to Azazel. Azazel is the original name of Iblis. So they go to him. Azazel, this sign has appeared within the heavens. Do dua that we do not become the greatest enemies of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He raises his hands. He says, oh my Lord, don't make them your greatest enemy. Do you see where the pride is? Nod, I can't see your faces, so I don't know whether... I'm used to people, you know, getting a bit interactive. So he said, do you see where the pride is? Because he thought, it can't be me. I could never become the worst enemy of God. And so he did dua for all of them and forgot about himself. And so 6,000 years of worship for naught. I've been praying for 30, 40, 50, 60, 70 years of my life. Tell me which barb of hikmah has opened for me. There are people that have been praying for 10, 15, 20, 30, 40, 60, 70 years of their life. Constantly, on time, every single day. Tell me which barb of hikmah opened for you. Because Amir al-Mu'mineen says, whoever is muqayyid, whoever is regular in praying his salah for 40 days, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will open the doors of wisdom for him. When he speaks, he will speak only wise things. He will have foresight, insight. Every action that he does, he will know what its repercussions are. But I've been praying for all these years, and I'm still the same. No veils have been lifted in front of my eyes. I don't see the angels. I don't see the jinn. I don't hear a reply to my salam when I go on ziyarah. Something that we have to think about. What is wrong? Could it be that I have become a slave to pride, to my own nafs? In the event of Mi'raj, one of the things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, says, Ya Ahmed, iftikharu an-nas fi ad-dunya ala sittati awjuh, says that the pride of mankind in the dunya is based upon six things. These six things are what they are proud of in this world. I'm trying to analyze my ibadat. Why haven't the barb of hikmah opened for me? Why haven't the curtains lifted in front of my eyes? Why can't I hear a salam when I say salam, why can't I hear a reply? Why can't I see the angels and the jinns and... But I've been praying all these years. It says the pride of man in the dunya, and woman, by man I mean everyone, is based upon six things. أَوَّلُهُ بِوَجْهِ الْحَسَنِ. The first is on their good looks. They're proud on how good they look. وَثَانِي بِالْفَصَاحَةِ. The second thing that they are proud of is their eloquence. وَالثَّالِثْ بِالْمَالِ وَالْوَلَدِ. The third thing they're proud of is their wealth or their children. وَالرَّابِعْ بِالْحَسَبِ وَالنَّسَبِ. The fourth thing that they're proud of is their lineage and their descent and their family. وَالْخَامِسْ بِالْقُوَّةِ. The fifth thing they're proud of is their strength, their power. والسادس بالملك. And the sixth thing that they're proud of is their kingdom. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts it into perspective. It says, Ya Ahmad, لمن افتخر بوجه الحسن. Says, why are they so proud of their good looks? تلفح وجوههم النار وهم فيها كالحون. Says, for on that day we shall take their faces that they were so proud of in this dunya, that they would look down on others that weren't as good looking as them. They would go towards sins of the flesh because of how good looking they were. And we will take that face of theirs and we shall burn it in the fire, a special type of burning. Kalihun. When you look at the books of Lughat, this burning is explained that those of you from the Indo-Pak subcontinent will know of a dish that is commonly made by the name of siripai. Yeah? Or pyre that is made with the head of a sheep or a goat. Kalapache, for those from Iran. One of the steps in making this particular dish is that a person must burn off all of the hair that is on the head of the goat or the sheep. And what they do is they put it in fire. Yeah? So just me then. Nobody else has seen this? You all look so bemused. It's amazing. The view that you get from up here. So you take the head and you place it in the fire. And it begins to burn off all the hair. And they burn it, burn it, burn it. It gets to a point where the lips recede and the teeth can be seen. This is kalih. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and on that day, those that were proud over their good looks, we shall grab them and place their faces in the fire such that their lips recede. لَمَنْ افْتَخَرَ بِوَجْحِ الْحَسَنِ. So what are they so proud of over their good looks in this dunya? Says, Ya Ahmed, لَمَنْ افْتَخَرَ بِالْفَصَاحَ. Why are they so proud over their eloquence? اليوم نختم على أفواههم وتكلمنا أيديهم وتشهد أرجلهم. Says that because on that day we'll seal their mouths. They were a sweet talker in the dunya. They knew how to weasel their way out of situations. They were people who were relied upon their eloquence to dupe, to try and win others over. Or they looked down at others that stuttered or were unable to speak in the way that they spoke. But on that day, we shall seal their mouth. And their hands shall speak to us. And their feet shall bear witness in front of us as to what it is that they did in this world. لَمَنْ افْتَخَرَ بِالْمَالِ وَالْوَلَدِ يَوْمَ لَا يَنْفَعُ مَالٌ وَلَا بَنُونَ. Why are they so proud over their children and their wealth in this world? For on that day, neither wealth nor children shall come to their aid. It will be just them and their a'mal. But in this dunya, they spent their time being proud over their wealth, being proud over their children. My son got accepted into this place. I made this amount of money. Or the whole time, you know what the problem with it is? Is that all of these things that we will talk about, all of them, the good looks, it's not a bad thing to be good looking. It's not a bad thing to be eloquent. It's not a bad thing to have children and to have wealth. Where is it that the problem arises is where a person begins to think this is all because of me. And doesn't thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for what it is that He has given. Otherwise there's no problem. Be as good looking as you want. You know, have whatever hairstyle and wear whatever clothes, obviously within the Sharia, that you want. There's no problem. As long as you acknowledge that what it is that you have is not because of you. It isn't because you put in the hard, long hours and that's why now you are wealthy, or you put in the long, hard hours and that's why you achieved this grade at school. It's because Allah allowed you to do so. It's because Allah gave you tawfiq to do so. That is a very critical point where an individual must acknowledge this in order to go forward spiritually towards Allah. This is why they're proud over their children and their wealth. On that day, neither wealth nor children shall come to their aid. Why are they so proud over their family and their descent? Because on that day, their descent and their family shall not come to their aid. There will be no relationships on the day of judgment. A mother will run from her son. A father will run from his daughter. Nobody will be worried about anybody except for themselves. Says, why are they so proud? Why are they so proud at their strength, at the power that they had within this world? Why are they so proud of it? That they could lift this much at the gym. This is the amount of influence they had over the community. The pride that they had over their power. Because on that day, we shall place over them angels that shall not listen or heed any call except that the call that comes from Allah, the order to punish comes from Allah. They will punish all this person's strength that they had within this dunya. Gone, nothing. لَمَنْ افْتَخَرَ بِالْمُلْكِ. Why are they so proud over their kingdoms? The houses that they have, the wealth that they have accumulated, the lands that they own. لَمِنِ الْمُلْكُ الْيَوْمِ لِلَّهِ وَاحِدِ الْقَهَّارِ. For on the day of judgment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will call across all of existence, all of those that were jabbar, all of those that were arrogant, all of those that looked down upon other people, all of those that were proud over the kingdoms that they had within this dunya, and He will address every single one of them. لَمِنِ الْمُلْكَ الْيَوْمِ. Tell me, whose kingdom is it today? It is only the kingdom of God. Six things that an individual is proud of within this dunya. Imam al-Hassan says, takabbur, kibr, is the thing that will destroy your deen. I'm praying, but in my heart, there is a sand's grain worth of pride. It will never allow me to be close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We asked one of our teachers of akhlaq, then what is the lowest level of pride that will stop a person from entering into Jannah? He said, even if a person is proud over the laces in their shoes, says it won't allow them to enter into Jannah. That's how much this action, this characteristic is hated by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That even that small level of pride will stop them from entering into Jannah. And then that pride goes further. You know, sometimes that's on the outward. I know I'm not proud of all of that. But then it comes to worship, because this pride, it takes different forms. When it comes into ujub, self-conceit, where I start viewing myself as better than other people. That I will want special treatment because I am Nabil Awan. So I will want people to stand for me when I come. I will be offended when no one says salam to me because of my ujub. Because I have fooled myself into thinking that I am someone. That ujub that will overcome me. That I come on the minbar and I recite, but I recite the things that the people want to hear because I want to become more popular. I want the people to keep on calling me back. And so I will recite what you want to hear. And on Yawmul Qiyamah, I will stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ya Rabbi, let me enter into Jannah through Bab al-Husayn. Because Bab al-Husayn is that door where the zakir of Ali Muhammad enter. Those that recited Marthiyah, those that helped to give out niyaz, those that volunteered for the majlis of Abi Abdullah, those that sponsored all these people that were associated to the majlis of Imam al-Husayn, those that attended, those that facilitated, they will enter through Bab al-Husayn. It is the eighth door of Jannah. I will stand there, my Lord, 16, 17, 20, 30 years of my life. You gave me opportunity to recite Majlis of Abi Abdullah. Allow me to enter through Bab al-Husayn. The reply will come, you did it for the people. Now go and find the community of JCC in Toronto and ask them for your ajr. You got what you wanted in the dunya. When this ujub comes within a person, sometimes the most humblest and the meekest of people. When Imam Khomeini discusses this in 40 hadith, he says like there are stages to it. They will sit there very humbly, those that are diseased with ujub. But when there is the mention of Salman and Abu Dharr, or the awliya of Allah, and their abilities and their ibadat, the person will think, oh, yeah, I do that as well, yeah. They will expand their chest as if to say, yeah, I do that. Or when someone comes and speaks about the importance of Salatul Layl, they will look around at everyone and be like, yes. Or when someone speaks about the ills of certain spiritual diseases, this individual, not realizing that they too are diseased, will look upon others and nod and think, yeah, this is good, he's speaking about this, because these people have that problem. That ujub will destroy a person. Happens so many times, you know, you go to Q&As and inshallah you have a Q&A coming up. And you know, there'll be someone, no, and this is not to offend my elders, but I've been to places like this, 60, 70 years old, and say, Maulana, could you please, explain to us the proper way of doing wudu? I say, 60, 70 years now you're asking. So no, not for me, for the youth. This is that ujub. Zahiran, an individual's niyyah. Zahiran, on the outward, is that to guide others, but inside, there is a problem. So that's why the hadith says that pride is the destruction of one's deen. But there's a difference between izzah and pride. Imam al-Hasan salawatullah wa salamuhu alayhi. is riding on his horse one day, dressed nicely. Imam al-Hasan alayhi salam was very good looking. And he dressed very well. He lived a good life. Not all the imams, you know, we have this perception that all the imams lived in like absolute poverty and no. Even Amir al-Mu'mineen himself addresses his sons. He says, look, you can't live like me. He tells Imam al-Hasan, read the will. So Imam al-Hasan alayhi salam is, you know, dressed nicely. He's on a horse with his adhama and his, you know, that aura that he had. And someone approached him. I said, Yabna Rasulillah, I think you have become diseased with pride. These nice clothes, this nice ride, you're looking good. You've become proud. Imam says to him, this isn't pride. This is izzah from Allah. There is a distinction where sometimes we look at someone and we say they're arrogant. Or we look at someone and say, this is pride. No, pride is at that point where a person themselves thinks that they are worthy. Izzah is where Allah thinks the person is worthy. And Allah gives the person maqam. And it's very easy to become aziz and then also become dhalil. Why? Because Allah has given me izzah and Allah has given me this maqam and has given me this adhamah, has given me this position in the eyes of the people. Then one day I start saying to myself, yeah, actually I deserve this special treatment. From being aziz, I fall and I become dhaleel. Imam al-Hassan says, no, this is izzah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This aura, this magnanimity that I have, these clothes that I'm wearing, this ride that I have, these looks that I have been given. Says this is honor from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nothing is from me. The second thing Imam al-Hassan says, that is the destruction of an individual, says wal-hirs, greed. Greed is the destruction of an individual. وَبِهِ خَرَجَ آدَمُ مِنَ الْجَنَّةِ. And it is because of this Adam was thrown out of Jannah. Because of that desire to try. And greed is that thing that an individual, no matter if they become diseased with greed, there is nothing in this world that can ever satisfy them. They become absolute slaves of this dunya. And Imam al-Sadiq, salawatullah wa salamuhu alayhi, he says, the example of this dunya, مثل الدنيا كمثل الماء البحر, says that the example of the dunya is like that of the sea water. No matter how much a thirsty person drinks it, it only increases his thirst until it kills him. This dunya is the same. It will draw you in with all its bells and whistles. And you will continue to drink from it. But that thirst will never be quenched. I'll say, you know what? I made this particular investment and I'm going to get out of it when it hits whatever price it is. Or I bought this property and I'm going to sell it as soon as the market becomes more buoyant again. So I make that intention. Market becomes more buoyant again. And I'm like, maybe leave it for a little while longer. It might go up. This is that greed. When a person doesn't have anything, they set it low. But when they reach that, they're like, maybe it could go a bit higher. And so they wait, and they wait, and they wait. Until one day. See, this greed is something that will never be quenched in a person. That attachment to the dunya will never be quenched. No matter how much they go, no, you know, this promotion, once I've got this promotion, I'm okay. I get the job, I get the promotion. And I'm like, you know what? No. I can go further. Now, again, there's nothing wrong with it. But what is the caveat? That Allah is at the forefront of my actions. I'm getting this job, but the higher I'm going up in this company, the later my salah is becoming, the more qadha I have. The longer hours I have to work, the more embarrassed I am to ask for a place to pray. That's greed. And it will lead to the destruction of an individual. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in one of the hadith Qudsi, he addresses the son of Adam, says, Yabna Adam, khalaqtuka lil'ibadi fala tal'ab. Says, I created you for worship. Don't play around. Don't mess around. I created you for worship. This is not to say that a person can't relax and play and have fun. But you make your fun and your play ibadat as well. Why? You make the niyyah that I'm going to play whatever sport it is, or this meeting of other brothers and relaxing and chilling out with them. I make the niyyah that this is because this body of mine, I'm keeping it healthy. Qurbatan ilallah. I'm going to meet my friends. Qurbatan ilallah. That becomes ibadat. He says, khalaqtuka lil'ibada fala tal'ab. Says, I created you for worship. So don't play around. وَقَصَمْتُ لَكَ رِزْقُكَ فَلَا تَتَعَبْ. And I've already apportioned for you your sustenance. So don't wear yourself out. فَإِنْ رَضِيتَ بِمَا قَصَمْتُ لَكَ رَحْتَ قَلْبَكَ وَبَدَنَكَ. Says, so, and when you are satisfied with what I have given you, what I have apportioned for you, I will give raha, I will give ease to your heart and your body. You won't be worried, you won't be stressed, you won't be staying awake late night worrying about what is to happen tomorrow. It says, because I've apportioned it to you. Know this, understand this. It says, but then he says, وَكُنْتَ عِنْدِي مَحْمُودًا. And if you do that, then you will become praiseworthy in my eyes. You will become praiseworthy in my eyes. وَإِنْ لَمْ تَرْضَى بِمَا قَسَمْتُ لَكَ. But if you're not happy with what I have given you, you're not satisfied with what I have given you, you're constantly complaining, oh, I can't make ends meet, oh, I don't have enough money, oh, I'm always in debt, oh, this is... Not just about money, about anything. You know, some people they just constantly complain. You can't ever make them happy. You'll just always find something to complain about. No, if it's at home, if it's in the masjid, wherever it is. And people avoid them. Oh Allah, I complain about something else. The niyaz wasn't warm enough. Or they didn't give the right niyaz. Or, you know, I came home and the house wasn't clean. Whatever it is. Just something to complain. Other people just get up. Oh, it's so cold here. Oh, it's too hot. All these complaints. It's a problem. These are spiritual diseases. We just think, oh no, it's my likes and dislikes. It's not. This rida of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, being radi, being satisfied with what God has apportioned to you, extends beyond just your wealth. And greed is that thing that takes away that rida, that a person keeps on looking around. They're married, but they just want to keep on looking around. They have wealth, but they want more. Because the grass is always greener on the other side. When greed overcomes a person. She says, and if you're not satisfied with what I have given you, فَوَعِزَّتِي وَجَلَالِي لَأَصَلَّطَنَّ عَلَيْكَ الدُّنْيَا. By my majesty and my honor, I shall break the whole dunya on top of you. You will carry the whole burden of this world. And I will make you run from morning to night like the animals run. Morning and night you will be worried about working, getting up early, going, working late, constantly worried, oh, I've not got enough, I need more, I need more, I need more. It says, I will make you run from morning to night like an animal. And then at the end of the day, when you are broken and you are tired, I will still give you what I had apportioned for you at the start of the day. Had you not put all that effort and forgotten me, I would have still given it to you. And he says, وَكُنْتَ عِنْدِي مَذْمُونَ. And then you will be considered punishable in my eyes. In another hadith of Mi'raj, it says to the Holy Prophet, says, Ya Ahmad, عَجِبْتُ ثَلَاثَةَ الْعَبِيدِ. I'm shocked from three types of my servant. Says, one of those, we don't have time to go into all of it, but one of those is that servant that knows that I have provided for him from the moment he was born until this point. I have never let him go hungry. I have never let him go homeless. I have never let him go naked. I have always given him. I have always provided to him. But yet he still stays awake at night worrying about tomorrow. Thinking, how will I make ends meet? What will my children do without me? Says, I'm shocked at that individual. Greed is the destruction of a person. It's destruction of the nafs of a person. Because they are never satisfied. They're never satisfied. They're always looking for something, always hunting, always after something. They can never sit still and be happy. And you look at those that had the rida, that had that satisfaction in their lives. They can never be bought. They can never be bought, even though they have nothing. Zahiran. Look at Abu Dharr. Look at Miqdad. Look at all of these individuals. Had nothing, but was satisfied. And thus even Muawiyah, with all his wealth coming and trying to buy them, cannot. But those that had greed, they were willing to kill the son of Rasulullah. Umar ibn Sa'd, for the sake of, you know, when Zuhayl goes and meets with Umar ibn Sa'd and says, Imam says, look, there's no point. He says, no, Imam, let me try. So he goes and he talks to him. He enters the tent and he says to him that, what is it that you think you're doing? And Umar ibn Sa'd looks at him and says, a Muslim sends salams to another Muslim before anything. And Zuhayr ibn Qayn looks at him and says, do you consider yourself to be Muslim? Do you consider yourself to be Muslim? When the dogs and the pigs are drinking from the banks of the Furat, and the children and of Rasulullah are thirsty. Says, why are you doing this? And Abi Abdullah has the same conversation with Umar ibn Sa'd. And they both of these conversations with Zuhair and with Sayyid al-Shuhada end on this point. Yes, but they've offered me the governorship of Ray. Zuhair comes back, says, Ya ibn Rasulullah, I'm sorry, he's killing you for the sake of Ray. And Sayyid al-Shuhada, when he comes to him, he says to him, Ibn Abd al-Sa'd, know this much, that you will never see the governorship of Ray. When greed overcomes a person, they come into the service of a zalim. They come into the servitude of a zalim. And now they're willing to kill the hujjah of Allah. قَدْ مُلِئَتْ بُطُونَكُمْ مِنَ الْحَرَامِ. Imam Hussein alayhi salam says in Karbala, he says, look, why is it that my words are having no effect on you? Because قَدْ مُلِئَتْ بُطُونَكُمْ مِنَ الْحَرَامِ. Because your stomachs are filled with haram. You've been taking money from the zalim. And you've been buying food and you've been eating that food. Was halal zahiran, but you ate it and now you're willing to kill the hujjah of Allah. Greed is the destruction of a person. There are times when greed is okay. We have hadith says one of the occasions where greed is okay, at the time for seeking knowledge. It says be greedy when you're seeking knowledge. Go as far as you can, as long as you can. Go as deep as you can. Continue to seek knowledge. There's no problem in being greedy in seeking knowledge. There's no problem being greedy in ibadat, trying to do as much ibadat as you can. يُصَارِعُونَ فِي الْخَيْرَاتِ. They rush towards doing good. These places where it is okay to be greedy. The last thing that the Imam says, وَالْحَسَدْ رَائِدُ السُّوءِ وَمِنْهُ قَتَلَ قَابِيلَ حَابِيلَ, says that jealousy is the reason for all deviations. The last thing that will destroy a person is jealousy. Why? Because jealousy is the reason for all deviations and immorality. And it was the reason why Qabil killed his brother. He was willing to kill his brother out of jealousy. Jealousy is that fire that consumes an individual. It's all consuming. It will never let go of you. When a person becomes jealous of someone, day and night, all they're doing is burning, trying to find some sort of fault within this person, trying to find some sort of issue within this person that they can highlight. They're looking at the way that they dress, they're looking at their car, they're looking at the way that they walk, they're looking at the way that they talk, and they're hating on them. Consumed by jealousy, maddened, insane with jealousy. So they can't see a clear path for themselves. On the other side, jealousy is haram. On the other side, we have ghibta. Ghibta is, you look at someone that has good. Jealousy is haram. You're going to hell for jealousy. But ghibta is good. And it's one of the sifat of the awliya of Allah. And what is that? You see something that someone has that you want. Lifestyle, eloquence, looks, whatever it is. You turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ilahi, give him more of that, but also give me some. Says this ghibta, there's no problem. Says when you look at something that someone has, then pray for them that they have more, but at the same time ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for you to have it. Also, just as a caveat, when you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for something, there's no problem. Like you want wealth, you want to be as the Sulaiman alayhi salam asked for kingdom. He asked for a wealth that had never been seen before. But at the same time, ask for the ability to be able to bear. Don't give me wealth and make me move away from the deen. Don't give me fame and let me become arrogant. You know, Du'a Makarim al-Akhlaq, Imam Sajjad alayhi salam, when he's speaking about the various moral attributes, he says, oh my Lord, don't raise me in front of the people darajatan illa hatatani inda nafsi mithla. That don't raise me one level in front of the people without lowering its equivalent within me. My Lord, don't give me wealth without the ability to bear this and pay my wajib dues. So there's no problem in asking for these things from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To do ghibta. These three things that the Imam says will be the destruction of a human being. Pride. That arrogance, jealousy, greed, says these will consume a person and they will destroy a person, not just in the dunya, but also in the akhirah. All of these consume a person. And one of our teachers of akhlaq was discussing this. He was saying that Yunus alayhi salam was consumed by a whale. Was consumed by a whale in that darkness. But we are consumed by so many different things. Our nafsi desires, consumed by shaitan and his trickery, consumed by our bad friends, consumed by family members that are taking us away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's darkness. Yunus alayhi salam was in that same darkness. How do we combat these spiritual diseases? Yunus alayhi salam, in the darkness of the belly of the whale, that is better than being in the darkness in the belly of shaitan. فنادى في الظلمات. But Yunus called out in the darkness, لا إله إلا أنت. ذكر يونسية. سبحانك إني كنت من الظالمين. Says recite that. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, فَاسْتَجَبْنَا لَهُ وَنَجَّيْنَاهُ مِنَ الْغَمْ وَكَذَلِكَ نُنْجِي الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Here, look at the mercy of Allah. He's not saying نُنْجِي الْأَنْبِيَاء or أَوْلِيَاء. Here he's saying مُؤْمِنِينَ. He says, when you're taken in by this darkness, recite this dhikr yunusiyya constantly, and Allah will free you from the darkness of these various attacks that are coming from all sides. This is from Imam al-Hasan alayhi salam. These three things. This Kareem Imam, that hilm of Imam al-Hasan alayhi salam, was shown even until his last moments. Imam al-Hasan alayhi salam was poisoned a total of 7 times. 7 times they tried to poison the Imam. And the Imam survived. But this last poison, they say that Muawiyah had it sent to him by one of the Caesars of Rome. And with it he wrote him a note and said, Muawiyah, know that this poison is so potent that if a drop of it was to fall within a sea, it would kill all the fish that are inside it. Do not use it on any God-fearing man. Muawiyah, through different wasilas, makes that poison reach Ju'ada, the wife of Imam al-Hasan. Gharib is that man who has an enemy within his own home. Your Imam was fasting on that day. Tomorrow will be the day of the Shahadat of the Imam. Tomorrow, think about this, that your Imam was fasting. When it came to the time of doing his iftar, she had already spilt the poison inside the water. The Imam opens his fast with that water, and straight away the Imam begins to call out. When an individual is in some sort of pain, some sort of distress within his home, the first place that he will turn to is his spouse. But here the spouse of Imam al-Hasan was his enemy. Who is it that he can call out to? Another person that an individual would call out to is their mother. But his mother left this world saying, Subbat alayya masa'ibun law anna. Then who does he call? They say that Imam al-Hasan, as the poison coursed through his body, he called out, he said, call my sister Zainab. Zainab alayhi salam came towards Imam al-Hasan. My brother, what happened? He says, go call my brothers. She goes and calls Abul Fadl al-Abbas. Abbas, they've poisoned our brother. She goes to Imam al-Hasan. She goes to the other sons of Amir al-Mu'mineen and calls them all to the house of Imam al-Hasan. Imam Hussein alayhi salam comes in towards him, says, my brother, tell me, who is it that did this to you? And here is the hilm, the forbearance of Imam al-Hasan. Says, my brother, I won't tell you who poisoned me. Leave it until Yawmul Qiyamah, and Allah will decide on that day. They take Imam al-Hasan, they lay him down. Say, that poison began acting fast in the body of Imam al-Hasan. such that the Imam began to vomit. They brought a tray in front of the Imam. As the Imam began to vomit, they say parts of the liver of the Imam began to fall out. The Imam al-Hassan, while in all of this pain, he's vomiting out parts of his liver. He hears his sister Zainab coming. He says, hide this tray. Zainab won't be able to bear to see this. Oh, Imam al-Hassan, where were you in Karbala? How would you have reacted when your Zainab saw Abi Abdullah in that state? Imam al-Hassan, he's breathing his last. He begins to look around the room towards all his brothers, his children, his loved ones, all of them crying. He looks at each one of them, bidding them farewell, until his eyes rest upon Abi Abdullah. He says, Hussein, my brother, let everyone cry, but Hussein, you don't cry. Why? Because there is no day like your day, O Abu Abdullah. It was as if Imam al-Hassan was saying, Hussein, I drank that poison, but poison will be forced into your body on the day of Ashura, as Hurmala fires that three-headed poisoned arrow into your heart. Hussein, today I'm surrounded by my loved ones that are bidding me farewell, but Hussein, on the day of Ashura, you will be all alone. Hussein, my daughters are here next to me, and their uncle calls are here, giving them solace, giving them condolences. Hussein, on the day of Ashura, your daughter will come to you and say, oh Father, Ruddana ila al-Madina. Father, why don't you just take us back to Medina? Father, don't go out. And you will have to explain to her Sakina. As if to say to him, Hussein, yes, after my death, my body will be shot with arrows after you have given me ghusl and kafan. But Hussein, in Karbala, there will be no one to give you ghusl and kafan. Hussein, my body will have arrows in it, and you will remove them from my body. But Hussein, your body will lie upon a bed of arrows. Hussein, now I lie upon a bed. There is a pillow behind my head. But Hussein, in Karbala, when you come down to the earth, وَذَا خَدَّهُ عَلَى الرَّمْلِ وَالتُّرَابِ, Hussein, your face will hit the earth and the stones of Karbala. Hussein, today my sons are by my side, and I can see them in front of me. But Hussein, in Karbala, you will see my son Qasim being trampled under the hooves of the horses. Hussein, you will hold my son Abdullah as Hurmala fires an arrow into his chest and kills him as he is in your lap. Hussein, my sons are here, but when in your last moments your Sajjad will be unconscious in the tent, your Ali Akbar faqattahu iraban iraba will lie mutilated on the plains of Karbala. Hussein, your Ali Asghar will be maghbuhim min al-uzni ila al-uzn, slaughtered from ear to ear. Hussein, you don't cry. Hussein, today my loved ones surround me. My sisters bid farewell to me. They have their brothers by their side. But Hussein, in Karbala, Zainab will be standing on Tilla Zainabiya. She will be begging with them, pleading with them. But she will see a shimru jalis on ala sadr al-Hussein. Ala la'anatullah ala al-qawm al-zalimin. Wa say'alimu al-lazina zalamu in yamun qalimin yanqalibun. Inna lillah wa inna ilayhi raji'un. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ya Allah, for the sake of these tears, Ya Allah, forgive our sins. Ya Allah, forgive the sins of our parents. Ya Allah, those of our parents that are alive, give them long lives. Those of our parents that have left this world, give them a place next to Ali Muhammad in Jannah. Ya Allah, those who are ill, for the sake of Imam al-Hassan, Ya Allah, give them shifa. Ya Allah, those who are in debt, clear their debts. Those who are in education, make them successful. Ya Allah, give us tawfiq within our life to see the rebuilding of Baqi, so we can go on the ziyarat of Imam al-Hassan. Ya Allah, give us tawfiq to go on the ziyarah of Abi Abdullah this year and every year. Ya Allah, keep safe the Azadar of Sayyid al-Shuhada, wherever in the world they may be. Ya Allah, hasten the reappearance of the Imam of our time and allow us to be amongst his true muntadirin, Matamir Hussein.
Lasha Qasim ka nazar aaya, Hasan yaad aaye. Lasha Qasim ka nazar aaya, Hasan yaad aaye. Us gariro hai bahut, us gariro hai bahut, Sheikh ko Hasan yaad aaye. Lasha Qasim ka nazar aaya, Hasan yaad aaye. Mehndi armaanon ki haaton mein laga kar maane, mehndi armaanon ki haaton mein laga kar maane. Sehra maate pe hai, sehra maate pe sajaya, to Hasan yaad aaye.